It's me. Leave a message at the beep.
Hey, man. It's me. You know, I could use your help. I'm going on a camping trip this weekend, and I don't need you to go with me. Obviously, I'd like that for, you know, more reasons than our wives would ever care to admit. Lickety lick. But no, the real reason is, my navigation skills in the wild are not that good, and my big concern is that I won't be able to find my way back to civilization with my head so far up my ass. Now, normally, as you know, in the wild, my head is up other places. Wild animals' asses, your ass. It doesn't matter. I just miss you, bro. Where have you been? Okay, give me a call back. I'm, probably only got coverage for a little bit longer. I mean, where I'm camping, I can actually see a cell tower, but, you know, excuses and stuff, so whatever. Whatever, it's fine. It's fine.
Ready? Alright, ready?
What a different intro that was. And why? Why, my friends? Because it's, you know, essentially St. Paddy's Day. It's March 17th for St. Paddy's Day. Today is, I don't know, the 13th or 14th. I'm recording this on the night of the 12th. And, you know, that's when I celebrated St. Paddy's Day, as any good Irishman should. And you know what they say, wherever you find four Irishmen, you'll always find a fifth. My friends, if you're hearing this on Sunday, I hope you remembered to set your clocks forward by 1 hour. Remember what they say, fall behind, spring into summer. I don't know the figure of speech, but what I do know is that in all sincerity, with a complete straight face, without an ounce of irony, my wife asked me, do we change the clocks 1 hour or two? I said, honey, one. It's always one. You know what? Put your clock on shuffle. It'll be an adventure. Who knows what time the kids will get to school? Noon? 5 a.m.? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So this is the first week back with my full 4K setup, and I am celebrating it in style. For those of you watching on YouTube, and come on, at least once in a while, you got to watch it on YouTube. I've got so much in store for you. High-res stuff, 4K stuff, pages and pages of graphics. I've spent hours putting it together and making it look, well, you know, just plain awesome. So what are we going to do this week? Well, it's probably going to be a little bit short, but that's fine because I'm making up for it with quality. And I've got some more insight into what St. Paddy's Day means in an actual Irish family. And yeah, we actually do celebrate it. It's the one time a year we get together, aside from Easter and Christmas and Thanksgiving and all the birthdays and, you know, other holidays and graduations. Really, really, we try to see each other as much as we can. At least that side of my family. That side of my family does. I don't know. It's like they say, families are like duct tape. They have two sides. The light side and the dark side. No, I don't think that's right. I'm pretty sure that's not right. All right, guys. Whew. Let's see if we've got a sponsor. This week's podcast is brought to you in part by Daylight Savings Time. No one knows what it's for, but we just do it. Daylight Savings Time. We can't get rid of it, because if we did, it'd be tyranny of Obama. Daylight Savings Time. Why not? I don't know. Ask Arizona. Daylight Savings Time. It's a what's up for dinner. Let's get started. I'm not a fan of the death penalty, and I think it should be abolished. But if it can't be abolished, we can at least do something about it to make it a bit more humane. Yeah, humane. So why not the death penalty? Well, according to the Innocence Project, there have been 337 post-conviction DNA exonerations in the U.S. That's a lot, man. That's a lot of people. 37 states. 20 of these people have spent time on death row swearing their innocence, proclaiming, come on, guys, I didn't do it. I swear I didn't do it. And then we go back later, look at the DNA. Oh, lo and behold, they actually didn't do it. How about that? That's so weird. Who would have thought? See, apparently there's a lot of imprecise methods used to convict people, things like eyewitness accounts, which are notoriously faulty, things like fingerprints, which are not necessarily super reliable, things like unvalidated or improper scientific, forensic testing. And, of course, you've also got cases where the FBI has intentionally fudged results to secure convictions, which is just horrible. It's just the worst. And then the other thing is, it's actually way more expensive to put someone to death than to keep them alive. Because, you know, you can say, well, it shouldn't cost that much. Well, they get more appeals, they get better representation, because their life is on the line, man. So, yeah, it turns out, according to some studies, it's $1 million more to kill someone than to put them, than to give them life in prison. And, you know, you can look at it a few ways. The idea with the death penalty is it's not a deterrent, because states with death penalties do not have lower capital crime rates. It's, you know, these are crimes of passion, man. Crimes of passion, crimes of addiction. So it's just crazy. It's crazy. And say, well, it should be cheaper. It should be cheaper. There's no reason it should be dragged out. It shouldn't take 1 million years. Well, okay, but that's not what we're arguing. You didn't ask me, should appeals be cheaper or quicker? The question is, should death penalty be allowed? So if we're going to go that route, and, you know, why wouldn't we? The next problem becomes one of how to put them down. Now, hanging is kind of brutal. It hasn't been used in a while. Lethal injection is all the rage, but we're not very good at that either. It should be really easy to put someone down, but it isn't. And the hardest part is when it comes right down to it, You know, the stuff that works is no longer made in the U.S. because we just don't make stuff anymore. No, we try to import it, but the countries that make it don't have the death penalty, so they won't sell it to us. We can't import it illegally, although that has been tried. So we try different cocktails, things that are unproven, untested, things that should work, but as we've seen in a number of cases, they just don't. So if we're going to put someone down, we got to do it humanely, and I've got the solution. I have it. I have it, and I will give it to you momentarily. But before we get to that, the thing is, what we've tried recently is mixes of quaaludes and, you know, barbiturates and opiates that just shut the body down, basically like an overdose would. The problem with that is watching it is really hard, because even though the brain is in the process of shutting down, parts of it are still fighting desperately for survival, and you get people gasping for breath and just sucking for every last ounce of air out of the room to just try and survive. So what if there was a way to kill someone quickly and painlessly? Firing squad doesn't work, because you know, you don't need a firing squad. You only need a firing dude. But dudes don't like shooting people. They don't like killing them. So what they do is, there have been instances where a firing squad lines up, everyone takes their aim, fires, guy doesn't even get hit, because none of them want to kill him. They try randomizing it and giving some dudes blanks and some dude live rounds, so they don't actually know who does the killing. It's just not a natural thing to do. So what do I suggest? I suggest death by rocket sled. It's so fast. It's so painless. Imagine there was a Mythbusters where they fired a rocket sled at a car to see if the car, what would happen. They knew what would happen. The car evaporated. It disintegrated on contact. It was a thing of beauty. So instead of lining the guy up at the wall for the firing squad, line him up for the rocket sled. On the count of 3, 2, 1, all he sees is the rocket's fire, something gets slightly bigger, and then he ceases to exist. There's not even any remains to bury. He's just gone. And if you're watching this rather than listening to it, there's a clip playing in the background. You'll get to see the rocket sled do its thing. You got to make it humane. So that's what I propose. If you're going to actually step up and put a man down, do it humanely. Do it with a rocket sled. It's not going to cost much more than it already costs to put someone down. And it's going to be way more entertaining. Way more entertaining. So there you go. Death by rocket sled. So one thing I've learned as a parent, and a historically poor-ish parent, is that shoes are expensive, especially high-quality shoes. Now, there are some options out there. But I talk with other parents, and I meet with other parents, and I'm always coming up with new ideas. Now, one place you can go for cheap shoes is Walmart. And when I say cheap shoes, I mean terrible shoes. If they last a month, 6 weeks, you did good. Now, they're not really that cheap. They're still $15-$20. So considering you only get a month out of them, that's even if it was 2 months, it's just not worth it. It's not a good deal in the long run. There's also Payless Shoe Source. Now, if you have more than one kid, they often have these BOGO deals, which are, you know, terrible. You buy one, you get the next one for half price. So really, it's 25% off of a price that's really not that exciting in the first place. So still, that's better than nothing. And those shoes will last 2-ish, maybe 3 months, maybe 4 or 5 months. You'll get a lot more time out of them. In terms of overall value, it's a better deal. Well, about a week ago, we went to a birthday party, and we were talking with some parents, and we came up with a solution for really high-quality shoes that you can get for a really good price. We were at this birthday party. It was at a bowling alley. And if you go on Tuesdays, they have this special where it's like $5 a game or something and $2 for the shoes. And what you do is, you know, you take off your shoes and you give those shoes to the guy. And then you just don't come back for them. And now your kids have bowling shoes, and I know what you're saying, a lot of people have worn those, and they have, but they're very high quality. They're designed to last for years of constant use. Now they'll scuff up, and yes, your children will fall on pretty much any tile or wood or polished floor, but spines grow back. Shoes do not. The shoes will endure any slipper fall, even if your child does not. So really, for $8 to $14, you get a pair of shoes that are going to last a year, and you can hand them down kid after kid. And if you need to, if they're not sticky enough, if they don't have good traction, just buy a can of Scotch Guard, and every month or so, just spray down the bottom, make them tacky again. You know, maybe do some adhesive spray, some rubber spray, put rubber cement and sand on them. Who cares? You're going to get a lot of life out of these shoes. And there's no contract you sign with the bowling alley. There's no rule that I know of that says don't steal shoes from the bowling alley. I mean, sure, it's a social contract, but it's a social contract you didn't sign. And if you don't sign it, it's not binding. So there you go. I mean, cheap shoes, man. And your kids can be, you know, hipster-ish. Other kids say, wait, why did these say for rental only? It's the brand. The brand name is rental only. Yeah, the brand name is rental. I got them at a thrift store. Who cares? It's none of your, you know what? My parents got them for me. My parents got me these shoes. I don't know where they came from. It's none of my beeswax. So just, you know, don't pay with a credit card and you should be fine. And the bowling alley can, you know, do whatever they want with those shoes. I mean, the old ones, it's fine. But the last thing is, don't go to a thrift store for shoes. Don't do it. The thrift stores I've seen have terrible shoe selection. The prices are not terribly exciting, and the shoes are worn to death. I've never seen good quality shoes at a thrift store. So there you go. I am helping America get cheap shoes that last. I'm doing good work here. I'm helping. I'm helping. Or so I say. So there you go. Cheap shoes, man. You can join the revolution or be left behind.
Technology.
There was this trend in the late 90s, early 2000s. Didn't even end until a couple years ago. I haven't seen it as much since then. Where they would show car commercials, and for some reason I will never understand, they would show the cars sliding sideways through the desert. It makes so much no sense to me. Our car has so much safety and so much traction. Here's footage of it sliding sideways through the desert. It doesn't inspire the kind of confidence I might want in a car, and it definitely doesn't make me want to buy it. I'm not sure. Whose idea was it to have cars sliding sideways through the desert? I guess I thought I had more on that to say than I do, but I don't. This week's podcast may be a little short. There we go. I mean, it's just... And again, if you're watching this, it's all over the screen, but it's just... I don't know. I mean, it looks like fun. It looks like fun, but right on the screen it says, seriously, don't do this. Do not do this. Professional driver on closed course. It's not a closed course, by the way. It's the desert. That is like the definition of an open course. Yeah. Well, good stuff. So at the beginning of the show, I started with a little song performed by my cousin, her son, and, you know, other people around, including a guy named Chucky, who I hope to have on the podcast in the future. He's a very talented musician. So this is kind of the fun we do. And if you watch this on screen, you'll get to see some annotations pointing to various Irish tropes. But it's just fun. This is kind of how we do. This is, you know, this is St. Paddy's Day in our family. We get a little nuts. We maybe kick back a few. It's, yeah, we go overboard. So please to enjoy.
What do you do with a drunken sailor? What do you do with a drunken sailor? What do you do with a drunken sailor? Her lie in the morning.
That's how we do it. That's St. Paddy's Day in an Irish household. And again, if you're watching the video version on YouTube, as well you should, the annotations are all over the place. Ish. A bit. It's, you know, I don't know. I don't know what kind of traditions you have in your family, but if your ethnicity doesn't have some kind of drinking holiday, I don't know. Perhaps you're missing out. All right. Well, I think at the very end of the show, after the very last segment, I'll throw in one more song from the night. Because, you know, we recorded them and they're all public domain, so why not? So stick around for that. But in the meantime, we got something else.
Political analysis. Politics.
In 2008, I ran an article on Election Morning called "Obama Will Win Today, and Here Are the Reasons Why." I had a number of conservative friends who, right up until the morning of Election Day, were swearing, it is going to be a Romney landslide. A Romney landslide! Boy, you know, haven't you seen how big his rallies are? Haven't you seen, you know, all these factors that play in? Surely it's going to be a Romney landslide. And I looked at it and I said, guys, I'm looking at all the different metrics. It's not. It's just not. So what I did is I was talking with a conservative friend the other day and he said, well, I'm just going to tell you, whether it's Trump or Cruz, it's going to be a Republican landslide. And again, I got to tell you, it's not. It's just not. I'm not saying it can't be a Republican win, but as of right now, it can't be a Republican win. And so let's look at some metrics here. 270 to win is saying, you know, there's only so many states that are actually even in play. Obviously, Washington, Oregon, California are going to go for the Democrat. Obviously, Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Georgia, South Carolina, those are going to go for the Republican. Just forget they exist. It's really going to come down to Florida, Ohio, Iowa, Wisconsin, Colorado, Nevada, the swing states. They're the same swing states as last time and the time before. They really don't change all that much. So just looking at it today, 270 to win says the Democrats already have a 217 to 191 advantage. That's big, but it's not insurmountable. Then you look at something like the Freedom Lighthouse map. This shows the Democrats at 237 to Republican 181. That's a huge deficit to have to, to have to offset. It's too big. It's big. And Ohio, again, it's a swing state, man. So then you look at head-to-head polling, Trump versus Clinton. As of today, Trump is not even within the margin of error. The probability that Clinton leads Trump is 99%, according to the Huffington Post poll of polls. You said, well, Huffington Post, that's biased. It's biased. Well, Huffington Post is biased, but the polls are not. The polls are the polls. So we're looking at this. Clinton leads Trump 49 to 43. So, you know, Sanders versus Trump, 50 to 42. That's an even bigger lead. I'm not confident Sanders is going to get the nomination. That seems a bit unlikely. But let's see. Going to Politico magazine, they're coming up with the same figures as Freedom Lighthouse. Democrats 247 to Republican 206. The Democrats only need to get to 270 to win, and based on this map, they're already at 247. That's an uphill battle, man. I don't care who your nominee is. And there's other factors too. So let's look at the betting sites, because that'll give you some good information. Predict It is a site where you can bet on who is going to win. In England, you can still legally bet on American politics, which is pretty interesting. So what do we got here? Let's find it. Will the GOP win the White House in a landslide? Current betting is 83 to 17 against. So basically that means if you really believe it's going to be a GOP White House landslide, cash in your 401k, man. Go bet it all on black or whatever color Trump is. Orange, I guess. Bet it all on orange because you're gonna make so much money. Mortgage your house, max out your credit cards, put all the money you can on it, because you're going to get better than 4-to-1 odds. It's amazing. You'd be crazy not to. You have to do this if you want to get rich. will, let's see, where is it? Which party will win the White House? Right now it's 64 to 37, meaning it is twice as likely that the Democrats will win as the Republicans. And you can say, well, this isn't scientific. Well, it's people putting their money where their mouth is. Surely, you know, this is just one of the metrics I used during the last election. So let's see. PredictWise, which takes betting from a number of different sites, even starker, Democrats 67% chance of winning, Republicans 33%. Now, 2-to-1 odds are not bad. They're not bad. But that is not indicative of the undercard being the guy who's going to win by a landslide or even win. Yeah, Hypermind, another betting site, 66 to 32, the White House will be won by a Democrat. Of course, it also says a 2% chance of someone else, but maybe they're thinking that the GOP will pull a fast one and try and push Trump out at the convention and he'll run third party and still win. I don't know. It's, you know, there are so many metrics here and all of them say the same thing. I have seen one chart that showed it's definitely going to be a Republican blowout. And it was so absurd. It had California and Washington both going for the Republican, going for Trump. That is, I mean, never say never. Nothing's impossible. But there is absolutely no reason. There's no basis in fact today to believe that. And there's other factors at play, too. There's the hatred factor. You know, Trump has the lowest approval ratings of any presidential candidate in recorded history. Now, second most hated in presidential candidacy history would be Hillary. But again, lesser of two evils. And Bernie actually has high approval ratings. So if it was down to Trump versus Sanders, you get a lot of people switching. Another disadvantage Trump has is he keeps saying, I don't want your money. This is a billion-dollar race. Is Trump really willing to pony up $1 billion or $2 billion just to stay competitive? If he's up against Sanders, that's definitely going to be enough. But Hillary's got super PAC money. And if Hillary gets the nomination, which looks likely at this point, the money's going to roll out, and it's going to roll out fast. If it's up against Sanders, Sanders volunteers love to phone bank. They've got a very sophisticated system which allows them to easily phone bank from home, even face bank from home, and it works. That's how Michigan went from a 20-point deficit to a narrow victory. And Sanders supporters are not letting up. So the other problem Trump has is he doesn't have the establishment support. And if he gets the nomination, it's not clear that he will get the establishment support because he is not going to support the establishment. He is not going to do what he's told, like Rubio definitely would and Cruz probably would. So Trump's going to face opposition from all sides. And unlike Clinton, unlike Sanders, he hasn't been vetted, not to the extent they have. Any dirt on Hillary, you've already found it. She's been running for president for 12 years. Sanders has been a very boring, very consistent politician. The thought that there's some skeleton in his closet it's pretty unlikely. But again, I don't think it's going to matter because I'm just not convinced he's going to get the nomination. So there you go. As of today, the Republicans not only will lose, but the idea of them winning by a landslide is laughable. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. Ha.
Joke of the week.
So when I was in Thailand, I had a number of pretty unusual experiences. A lot of it had to do with the culture of value, the culture of acceptable norms. Anyway, I'm walking down the street one day, Driblets with me, we're hanging out, and I see this place, it's got a sign out front, it says, and I'm not going to say the Thai doll that bought, I'll just equate it to dollars. It says $2 cheeseburger, $3 chicken sandwich, $5 hand jobs. And I was like, hey, Driblet, I'm going to head into this place. And he's like, no, dude, don't. I was like, no. I've got got some money on me. I think this is going to be great. And he's like, you can't, it may seem cheap until it comes to a lifetime of Valtrex. And I'm like, I don't know what Valtrex is. I don't get the joke. He's like, all right, I'll meet you back at the hotel. I'm like, you don't want to come in? You know, my treat. He's like, whoa, that's really weird. I'm like, okay. Oh, I don't think it is. I mean, it's Thailand. I mean, you know, kind of whatever goes. So I go in, and there's 2-3 waitresses in there, and this beautiful girl comes up to me, and she's got, you know, like red and blue striped hair, and she smiles. She's got this short skirt on, and she says, hello, welcome. And I'm like, hello. And I said, hey, are you the one that gives the $5 hand jobs? She said, yeah, I am. I said, awesome. Would you do me a favor and go wash your goddamn hands, because I'd like a cheeseburger? And, you know, she was a bit put off, but, you know, it's fine. So I sit down, and I've got my cheeseburger, which tastes like and probably is horse meat. It's fine. It was a bit dry and gamey, but, you know, she looked pretty dry and gamey too, so what am I losing at this point? And I said, so you're a lady of the night. And she said, nope, 24/7. We do this all day. Go, oh, right. My fault. I guess I didn't think that through. I said, you ever have any funny stories about, like, customers or whatever? And she goes, yeah. These two dwarves came in. And I go, whoa, dwarves. They don't like to be called that. They like to be called little people. She goes, no, they actually like to be called dwarves. I said, dwarves? Are you kidding me? Dwarves? Like the seven dwarves? Like, oh. Okay. So anyway, these two gnomes come in. And they go off, they hire two ladies, they go up to their rooms, and they come back out, and one of them's like, oh, man, I heard you got off pretty well, but I couldn't even get it up. He goes, what? What did you hear? And he goes, no, I heard you in there. The whole night you were like, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, And he goes, no, I couldn't even get up on the bed. But that happened. That was a true story. And so I said, you know, well, it sounds like, you know what you're doing, but I'll stick with the terrible cheeseburger. Thank you. And she goes, I'm like a gun. If you cock me, I will blow. It's like, oh, gross. Just gross. And I wanted to make like another 50 jokes about it, but prostitute jokes, as you know, are horrible. Horrible. Just horrible. They're horrible. But to veer off the fake joke of the week for just a second, no, this is a true story here. I was getting a foot massage, and I didn't realize it was a legit massage / rub and tug place, and the lady kept saying, come upstairs. And I was like, no. She said, why? Because no. Because I'm not interested. Because no. Just no. All the reasons, no. So, without exaggeration, she goes, you're fat. I mean, all Americans are fat, but you're really fat. How come you're so fat? Why are you fat, you fatty? Twinkle, twinkle, little whore. No, your legs are not a door. No, keep them shut. Keep them shut. Keep them shut. It's not. And, you know, you're upstairs, and this fake cop comes in, and he's like, yes, I am official security. Yes, first of all, you're not a cop. You're not even official security. You look like a kid in a rented security guard costume. You're 80 pounds soaking wet. And he goes, hey, man, hey, you know how many cops it takes to throw a Farang down a flight of stairs? And I was like, Farang? Oh, right. That's like the Thai insult comparable to gringo. No, I don't get your joke. How many fake knockoff fraud joke non-real security non-cops does it take to throw a Farang down a flight of stairs? And he said, none. He fell. And he grabs me by the scruff of the neck, by my shirt collar, and he pulls as hard as he can, and I just sit there. Again, this guy's like 80 pounds soaking wet. I'm like, I've seen Katoy with bigger biceps than you, and pardon me, but they also dressed better. So I left. I went back to the hotel. Driblet wasn't there. He was, I think he was getting his credentials on, damn it, I can't remember the name of that street. There's a whole street where you can get college credentials for anything for like a couple $100. It's amazing. I should totally do that next time I'm there. And so I sit down out front. I've got like 3 hours until I can actually go to sleep. And this Australian guy's there. And I'm just sitting there, and he's like, oi, prick. No, I don't know. I don't remember how he sounded, but I told him what happened, and he goes, yeah, I actually went to a prostitute last night, and, you know, she got naked and she laid down and all that. And I stopped and I paused and I waited. And she goes, what? What's your problem? Is this the first one of these you've seen since you crawled out of one? And I said, no. This is the first one I've seen that I could actually crawl back into. Oh, Australians. You're so classy. Just amazing. So, of course, when I came home, I told the missus about the whole experience. And she was, you know, even though nothing happened, I didn't do anything, she was very upset. And she goes, you know what? You know what? You know what? I'm leaving. And I go, you're leaving? Where are you going? She goes, I'm going to go to Las Vegas and sell to other men for $100 what I've been giving you for free. What are you going to do? And I was like, well, I guess I'm going to go to Vegas and see you try and live on $300. Again, these are all true stories. True stories from my life. True stories from the greater sum of life. From the tree of life. So, yeah. I'm just glad I have someone to share them with. And I'm glad that that someone is you. Nobody's actually sharing these moments with me. That's all right. I have tremendous personal fortitude, and I, like many other karaoke singers, will survive. Oh my God, you guys, we've already reached the end of the podcast, and to my tremendous surprise, we've actually managed to fill the time. I started late this week. I went really hard on quality, and for those of you watching the segments on YouTube, you know I did. I brought bonus features, I brought graphics, I brought citations. Oh man. So this, the Glossy News 4K podcast, news review, bullshit, whatever. I am, as you know, Brian K. White, and I am here for you guys. I don't know why. I don't know who you are, but My stats keep climbing every month, so obviously I'm doing, I don't know, something right. I will have this podcast available in glorious 4K, though a bit behind schedule, as it takes absolute ages to upload. So, you know what you can do in the meantime is follow me around the web. Follow me on Reddit, Facebook, Twitter, Libsyn, iTunes, all those good places, YouTube, you name it, by going to glossynews.com/podcast. And yes, oh yes, my yes, I will say it again. I've got the new 4K camera. I've got the new microphone back. I've got, you know, essentially everything I need. I've even got some new audio segments from Greg the Hero, who does damn near all of my stuff these days. The only thing he doesn't do is the intro and the outro, and those are from Kevin McLeod of Incompetech.com. I'm sorry, Kevin. I'm phasing you out, and it's nothing personal. You do great work, but, you know, I've bought exclusive material and I'm going to use it. It's just how it is. So stay tuned, because at the end of this, there will be one more segment from my Irish family hootenanny, my St. Paddy's Day party with the cousins. It's, you know, I'd like to say it's great, but more likely it's good. And good in that, you know, if you liked what you heard already, you'll like this one too. So no, we're back to full length. We're back to full length. And, you know, I've got a closing thought. I always have a closing thought. Before I tell you what that is, I must first say, once again, the social media thing, it's awesome. You gotta get on board. I mean, I'm not on board, but, you know, I'll get there when you get there. We'll get there together. No, the closing thought for this week is there are two secrets to success. Number one, never reveal all of your secrets. And, you know, that's it. So let's just fade into one more song from my cousin Elizabeth. And, you know, guys, if you're a subscriber on iTunes or YouTube, you will hear from me again next Sunday. Otherwise, you know, Monday or later, who knows, you know, it depends how you find me. So here we go. Let's do it.
In a neat little town they call Belfast, not in Texas to stay I was bound. And many's the happy moments that I spent in that neat little town. Just sad misfortune came over me and caused me to stray from the land, far away from friends and relations, in search of the black velvet band. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds, you'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with the black velvet band. As I was walking down Broadway, not intending to stay very long, I met with the frolicsome damsel as she came a-tripping along. Oh, what she pulled out of her pocket and slipped it right into my hand. On the very first day that I met with her, that luck to the black velvet band. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds.
Everybody,
you'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with the black velvet band. before judge and jury next morning. The both of us did appear, and a gentleman placing his jewelry, the case against us was quite clear. 7 long years transportation, right on down to Bandito's land, far away from friends and relations, in search of the black velvet band. Here, everybody, her eyes, they shone like the diamonds, in which she was queen of the land, and her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with the black velvet band. So come all you jolly young fellows, and please take a warning from me. Whenever you're out on the liquor, beware of the pretty Holly. She'll fill you with whiskey and porter until you're not able to stand. And the very next thing that you notice, the evil landed in Bandito's land. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds, you'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with a black velvet band. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds, you'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with a black velvet band.
Oh my goodness.
We're here now, guys. We're ready. Chucky's here.
Yeah, we're tuned up. We're ready to go.
All right. Am I still tuned with you?